Thank you so much for coming to this memorial service for Rick Wells. It means a great deal to Jeannie and all the family to have your encouragement and your support. We know that you are only representatives of the many, many people who have been touched by his life and ministered to by him, and only eternity will be able to measure the impact of any believer's life, and certainly that would be true in his case. But we're extremely grateful that you've come to represent all of those folks who were drawn closer to the Lord through the influence in the ministry of Rick. We turn, first of all, for our comfort to the Word of God, to what God has revealed to be true about matters that we face when we face death. Psalm 91, first of all, says, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For it is he who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you may seek refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and bulwark. You will not be afraid of the terror by night, or of the arrow that flies by day, of the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or of the destruction that lays waste at noon. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not approach you. You will only look on with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. For you have made the Lord my refuge, even the Most High your dwelling place. No evil will befall you, nor will any plague come near your tent. For he will give his angels charge concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will bear you up in their hands, that you do not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and cobra, the young lion and the serpent you will trample. Because he has loved me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him securely on high, because he has known my name." The Apostle Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, "For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven, inasmuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that that which is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight, we are of good courage, I say, and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be present at home with the Lord. Therefore, we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or useless." And then the promise of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and following. "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's bow in prayer. Our Father, we thank you that the promise of Holy Scripture is that the one who has set his love on you, you will set on high. And we know that you have done that in the case of Rick, that no harm befell him, no evil. He was delivered from our presence into yours. He who walked by faith now walks by sight. He who was in the body is now absent from the body and present with his Lord. He has been granted new and eternal life, a new body, a new purpose, a new realm, which transcends even our most extreme imagination. Because eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those that love him. We thank you one day that when that trumpet sounds at the rapture of the church, his body, along with the bodies of all who have died in Christ, will be gathered together with that glorified spirit now in your presence, and he will take on that final eternal form and be even like the risen Christ. But until that time, he rejoices in your presence among the spirits of just men made perfect. We look forward to the time of our own reunion with him and all the saints who have gone before. We thank you for this hope and this promise, and we know that this is the ultimate and only real comfort. When someone dies without Christ, we understand that the only comfort is to look back and remember. But when someone dies in Christ, the real comfort is to look forward and understand the glories of eternal life. Thank you for Rick's life, his family, his impact. We know that that will go on. He, being dead, yet speaks. But more importantly than lasting memories are the realities of living hope. We look forward to that reunion in your presence. We thank you for that promise. In the name of Christ, amen.
Thank you. although Rick never got to sing that in a service, he did get to rehearse it with us, and he made mention to me how much he enjoyed that particular arrangement of How Great Thou Art. He was so supportive of the music ministry, and he always had a smile on his face and always had a quick ad lib to just encourage the choir members. What a delight to have him with us. And both he and Jeannie served almost 20 years in the choir before the Lord took him home. One of his favorite hymns is It Is Well With My Soul, and I'd like you all to join me as we sing that right now. It's 493 in your hymn books there. And I know it's difficult to sing at a time like this, but do your best as unto the Lord. And let's stand and we'll sing the first and the last stanza.
It is highly likely and probable that during this service and throughout the evening that you will hear many superlatives to describe the life and legend of Rick Wells, which is common at funerals. Frequently, they're true. In Rick's case, they're not superlatives. They're just accurate descriptions of a phenomenally gifted and humble man of God. Rick's involvement in the ministry to children called Awana began when his own children were 4 and 5. He led the Awana Club at Venice Baptist as commander for 11 years. During that time, he served on the Los Angeles Awana ministry team, facilitating Bible quizzing, leadership conferences, Olympics, and summer camps. In 1996, he became the event coordinator for the 160 churches in Awana, LA. The Awana Teen Ministries, JV and Varsity, captured his heart.
Rick and friends coached them to 3 national Bible quiz championships and 10 consecutive national Olympic championships. And when they took more than one team, they frequently took second place. Now, he mentored thousands of leaders and kids, laboring joyously and diligently to encourage them to love Christ and to serve Christ, to love God's people. I'm one of those thousands. My introduction to Awana, to the Awana culture, was when our church sent its first clubber to Awana camp. Now, as the pastor, I had to know the character of these people who were going to receive our children for a week, and as the father of that camper that went that summer, I went as a camp counselor. Now, in the first few moments of training, there was no doubt that Rick's passion was to see Christ formed in the hearts and minds of camp leadership, and that would assure the direction of leading children and leading campers Christ-likeness. Now, I believe this could summarize the toil of Rick's life: proclaiming Christ, warning everyone, teaching everyone with all wisdom, laboring as a faithful steward with all those gifts that his gracious Savior powerfully worked in him. Now, it wouldn't be easy to provide a chronology of Rick's work in Awana. That would require a long line of lists and names and faces, not to mention the thousands of hours at hundreds of events and years of camp. I asked one of those young persons recently involved in Awana during those years, if you could tell people one thing about Rick, what would you say? And the response was instantaneous. He said, "Well, he loved me." And it was nothing for him to stand 16 hours with me in a sweaty, crowded gym because he loved me. Amen. Now, I think it would be more fitting to mention the character qualities of Rick as they were demonstrated in his Awana ministry. Rick was brilliant. You have to understand that he got it. He captured that activities and events were useless and wasteful if they did not help everyone involved take the next step of faith. From young to old, counselors to campers, coaches to participants, ticket takers to spectators, his genius crafted a philosophy of ministry that served as a spiritual plumb line to measure everything in the light of truth. And together with an administration and a methodology that could achieve those goals, whether it was to introduce someone to Jesus or to help them consider even a decision for full-time ministry, he worked that all together. That was Rick. He was a courageous and he was an honest man. As he put together lists for camp or teams of teens, he had no fear of telling very good, capable athletes and their parents that they weren't qualified for a position at camp or on the team because they didn't memorize the required Bible verses, or they didn't complete the required Bible work. He defended truth. He defended the truth of the gospel, and he lived for that. Now we all know we're going to die, and that fact alone compels believers, true believers, to manage their time, to mark their words, to memorize truth. Rick did all those things. But Rick took that urgency and applied it across all aspects of life. And he applied it to the reality that he knew he could not reach every single young life. So he and a few others developed and trained a ministry team of about 60 people across a spectrum of professions and encouraged them to use their gifts to the end that young lives were more like Christ by their interaction with them. He worked that into us, and he worked it to God's glory. It changed our lives. It actually changed my life. It sharpened my own character, and it has defined the character of my own ministry. And Rick knew all those young lives in all the area wide of the Los Angeles ministry. He knew their names. He knew their churches. He knew their leaders and he knew about their families. He was personal. Now, when I say he knew their names, I don't mean he knew of them. He knew them on sight. It was an amazing thing to watch. And when I say that it was hundreds of them, I'm probably conservative. He probably knew more than several thousand young lives' names on a moment's notice. We had frequent conversations that he initiated about specific young people at my little Spanish church about 60 miles away from here. Now, I'm sure he had conversations like that with many more leaders across his county. And he prayed for them. Jeannie, thank you for sharing. Your husband, thank you for completing him for that ministry. Thank you so much. Greg and Cheryl, thank you so much for giving us your daddy. We are truly different because of that. You may be one of Rick's associates from work, one of his professional associates and or acquaintances, and today Rick would say to you something very dear to his heart. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It's all about Jesus. You may be one of those young lives that Rick reached, one of those young lives that he touched and loved and by his ministry. Maybe you've faltered in your walk. Rick would just say it straight. Stop kicking against the goads. Repent. Return. Told me that frequently. Thank you.
Your brother's face. finally see with his own eyes that everything's okay. And I just have to wait, 'cause I know that day is coming.
Thank you. When you start talking about joy and hope, there's to me, that's a vertical relationship between us and God. A horizontal relationship is like, you know, your family, your friends, your companions, what you do, that present over there. That's kind of all takes place on this plane here. But God sent His Son so that we could have hope in this life. And that's a vertical relationship between God and us. And that's why we have hope. That's why we belong to Christ. And that's why God sent Him vertically to live horizontally, to raise again vertically, so that we can do the same and have a relationship with God. Anyway, so that's my 2 cents.
It is my privilege and honor to give my brother's eulogy. He would normally be up here doing this with me. That's what we did at both of our parents' memorial services. And he would study me, and I would study him. So, Rick, you have to study me tonight. Thank you all for being here and sharing this time of grief and celebration of Rick's life and service with us. I will read remarks compiled about Rick from the family and close with a few personal reflections. Warren Richard Wells, Ricky, Rick, Bro, Dad, Poppy, as he was affectionately called within the family, was born on March 28, 1947 in Honolulu, to Warren Brooks Wells and Erna Lee Harper Wells, a young couple recently married and stationed in Hawaii after World War II drew to a close. Upon returning to California, they lived briefly with Warren's parents, Clarence and Blanche Wells, in Pasadena. Ricky was an adorable, active, and inquisitive baby. He was followed 18 months later by younger brother Kenneth Brooks Wells, me, born in Pasadena. The young Wells family moved to Mar Vista. Rick's dad, Warren, worked for Don Lee Broadcasting in the pioneer days of television, becoming chief engineer at KHJ Television and later working for Disney. Living near Venice Baptist Church, the Wells family became active church members. Warren and Erna Lee took much joy in raising their sons Ricky and Kenny in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Both sons were baptized and became active in church ministry, participating in church-sponsored sports at which Rick excelled. The family moved to Culver City, but kept Venice Baptist, also known as VBC, as their church home. As teenagers, the boys were part of a large youth group that included Jeannie Newman, the future Mrs. Wells, and her brothers John, Richard, Paul, and sister Sharon, and future in-laws Tom Nichols and Kim Pedrick, and many others here tonight. In their early teens, several years before Rick and Jeannie became a couple, Rick, Ken, and Jeannie sang duets and trios in the church music program. Ken and Jeannie would often accompany with piano and organ. Eventually, this routine grew into something larger, the VBC Singers, about 15 young people, initially directed by Ken and sometimes by Rick, traveling to different churches. Rick was always extremely popular and very much a guy's guy. He was a terrific athlete, excelling at baseball, Pop Warner football, and high school basketball as a point guard. He was president of a newly founded YMCA club. In addition to being a fine student with a keen interest in math and sciences, Rick participated in Boy Scouts through Troop 19, founded by his father, and was the youngest Eagle Scout in the United States at that time. Rick loved fishing, hiking, and climbing, and regularly went camping with his dad and his brother. For nearly a decade, they camped about once a month, basketball schedule permitting. At the end of high school, Rick began the next significant chapter of his life. At age 18, he started dating Jeannie Newman. The Wells family had a favorite restaurant in Malibu called the Sea Lion, so naturally Rick took Jeannie there, and the rest is history. Jeannie was a beautiful young woman, a talented singer and pianist, and a math whiz. Rick went to Cal State Northridge, majoring in civil engineering, cum laude, and obtained a Master of Science in Structural Engineering in 1971, graduating summa cum laude. Jeannie was a math major at Biola College. The two were married in 1970 at BBC, and their children, Gregory Richard Wells and Cheryl Diane Wells, were born in 1976 and 1977. Shortly after marrying, Rick got his first job as a civil engineer for the Department of Water and Power, responsible for aspects of power design and construction, public works management, and the design for the LA Aqueduct and reservoirs in Mono Basin, Owens Valley, and LA Basin. He also designed key features of the Castaic Dam. As his engineering career progressed, an opportunity presented itself with a shift to the airport planning and management for the Los Angeles World Airports, or LAWA, where he remained for 30 years. During his time at LAWA, Rick progressed from positions in civil engineering and transportation planning to chief of airport planning and interim deputy executive director. He was known for his skill at administration and personnel management. Some of the projects at LAWA included the $70 million LAX expansion program, oversight of renovation of the Tom Bradley International Terminal, and leadership in the planning effort for the LAX master plan. These are just a small sample of the projects that Rick championed. Following the terrorist attacks of September 11th, Rick was instrumental in upgrading rigorous security procedures for all LAWA systems airports. LAX was the only large airport in the United States to meet the deadlines mandated by Congress. After 39 years of outstanding service with the City of Los Angeles, Rick retired in 2009, although he continued to work on projects at LAX as an independent airport planning consultant. Upon retirement, Rick was honored with a special commendation from the City of Los Angeles for his faithful service. He never took a sick day. During these busy professional years, Rick was faithfully engaged in ministry as well, as you've heard. At Venice Baptist Church, he served as a deacon, led the choir and congregation in music, and sang in a men's quartet. And Rick and Jeannie served as leaders of a youth group. Eventually, when his son Greg was 5, Rick became the Awana commander. He dearly loved this ministry and the children in it. His skill and passion caught the attention of Larry Fowler, the Los Angeles Awana missionary, and Rick and Jeannie were asked to join the greater LA ministry team, where they served the 160 LA church clubs for over 10 years. In 1992, Rick moved his family from their home in Mar Vista to Northridge and their church home from VBC to Grace Community Church here. His family was nurtured at Grace with both excellent teaching of the Word of God as well as from the example and attention of godly leaders. Their lives were enriched as they hosted high school and college ministries, masters, college students, and pastors attending the Shepherd's Conference. In addition to Jeannie and Rick's continued work at Awana, their primary ministry was in the choir, where they found a new family of like-minded people dedicated to the worship of Christ in music. Rick and Jeannie were also devoted to displaying the love of Christ to extended families and friends. They were known for always keeping an open door and defined what Christian hospitality should look like. Rick was equally devoted to his parents and provided tremendous love and care, financial planning, and other assistance as their health failed. Rick and Jeannie supported their children with Christian education all the way from kindergarten to their graduations from the master's college. Rick's inherent and acquired planning capacities also made him a brilliant planner of vacations, games, cross-country ski trips, cruises, and more. These times were always filled with surprises planned from morning till night. Rick had enormous energy. He took great delight in planning exciting excursions and seeing the joy and sometimes exhaustion of his family and friends as they enjoyed all he had planned. Rick's gift of planning, coupled with his love of traveling, allowed Rick and Jeannie to enjoy adventures all over the world. After spending his life caring for others, Rick was forced to start thinking of himself as he was given the greatest physical challenge of his family, ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease. Rick received the diagnosis only a few weeks after his mother's death about 9 months ago. A progressive neurologic disorder with no known cure and few treatments, Rick faced that terrible diagnosis with great grace and courage. He did not hesitate to let friends know. He asked for no sympathy. He worked hard alongside Kent and me to finish our mother's affairs following her death. Rick continued making heroic efforts to travel and connect as he could with family and friends. It was difficult for all of us to watch helplessly as the illness took its course. Rick made it tolerable by his honesty, attempts to make it as easy as possible for his family and friends, and enduring faith that he was following his master's course. Never wanting to be a burden to anyone, especially his family, he fought to be independent even to his final days. The outpouring of support and love from his family and friends over the course of his illness was a moving experience, not just for those of us witnessing it, but to Rick himself. Rick demonstrated and verbalized his trust and dependence in God throughout his life. His great strength and not so secret weapon, other than his faith, was his family. Jeannie, the absolute rock and love of his life, was as devoted to him as he was to her. And they were both devoted to their amazing children, Greg and Cheryl, their spouses, Kristen and Andy, and their five grandchildren, Katie, Justin, Macy, Tobin, and McKenna. As I prepared to give this eulogy, memories flashed before me. Running after our dog, Bimbo, after he jumped over a five-foot fence. Picking up a tortoise together after elementary school and carrying him home. Parading in our cowboy outfits at Grandma's. Screaming on the roller coaster at the Pike. Singing gospel songs together. Sleeping in the pool room near the fireplace. Arguing over physics homework. Shaking hands at your wedding. Countless games of ping pong, which I rarely won. You being upset with yourself when I did. Holding each of your children on the day they were born. Burying our parents and singing at funerals of our grandparents and parents. And sending each other 100 emails in the last year, ending with love you or later, bro. Thinking of you in heaven now, the best I can still say is love you, later bro. Jeannie, I will forever be grateful to you for your love and care for Rick and your grace and faith over the years, but especially in this last difficult year. Greg and Cheryl, please know that your father adored you and spoke of you with great love and faith in you from the day you were born. Kristen and Andy, thank you for joining our family, loving Rick and Jeannie and your spouses, giving Rick his grandchildren, and being there for him in so many ways. Katie, Justin, Macy, Tobin, McKenna, you must know that you were the most precious and loved people to Poppy, your grandfather, and that your life and love filled him and Jeannie with great joy. To all of Rick and Jeannie's friends and colleagues, thank you for being their extended family. For all of us here, may we be so blessed as my brother to have a life filled with love, faith, plans developed and realized, friends, and enduring purpose. Warren Richard Wells departed from his body on March 24th, 2013. However, he is even more alive in heaven and in our memories and hearts. In closing this eulogy, we would like to share one aspect of Rick's life that is difficult to express by words alone. It is no secret, as you've seen already, that Rick's family was blessed by God with a love for music. But it isn't simply the performance of a work that brought Rick joy. He knew that he served a living God worthy of our praise. In 2007, Rick's family and friends were gathered by Jeannie to perform her compositions for her senior music recital for her degree at Cal State University at Northridge. The choir presented John Piper's poetic version of the story of Job, which Jeannie had set to music. Rick was extremely proud of Jeannie and loved singing the piece. But in these last 9 months, Rick lived in his own life the true meaning of Job's call to suffer and rejoice, as shared in the final song of that work. It is our family's great honor to share a video of that performance with you as we celebrate together the life and service of Warren Richard Wells.
And what did you say, Papa, when the Lord was done? I said, Amen, and bowed as low as I could bow. Come here, my lass. I'll show you how. And she crouched before his feet. He picked her up, and with a sweet and tender grip, he said, Watch this. And on her cheek, he put a kiss.
My name is Andy Carpenter, a wife of Cheryl and son-in-law of Rick and Jeannie Wells. And I would like to take this opportunity to describe in brief a bit of the depth of the love that this family is for our dear dad. You are all his friends and family, so you know how great he was. Each of you have your own unique stories to tell of the legend we know as Rick Wells. We could describe the fun things that we have done with him, but rather than recount funny stories or great times that we had, I would like to share of my observation of a great man in his last few months on earth. I've known Rick for just over 12 years and have observed a man of unwavering faithfulness. Faithfulness to his family, faithfulness to his friends, faithfulness in the church, but most importantly, faithfulness to the Lord and to the truth of his word. Greg and I have talked, and both of us feel the overwhelming burden of carrying on the legacy of such a man. He was great and he was stalwart. When we found out about Dad's diagnosis, Dad's first reaction was sorrow, but not for himself, but rather that he would miss out on the family that he loved so dearly. Romans 5:3 states, "More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts." I know that Dad questioned God as to why he gave him this terrible illness. And we all question God. But Dad equally trusted God, echoing Christ's trust in the Father just hours from the cross. It is often the case that old age can bring out the true nature of a person. Trials can also bring to the surface your true core. It was during this trial that our dad's true character shone the brightest for me. Cheryl and I were blessed to spend 4 weeks with Dad just before he died. And I can testify that the man we remember today withstood the crucible that God had prepared before him. It was not unfair or unjust that God decided to give Dad this trial. Rather, it was the trial that allowed Dad to reflect the grace and mercy of our Savior Jesus Christ. We do not mourn as the world mourns, and we don't grieve like they do, for there's no hope for a non-believer. Rather, we're confident in Rick's homegoing. Not for sentimental reasons, as if I'll make it to heaven somehow. You know, he's in a better place. We are confident that Dad is with Christ because we are confident that he had put his trust in the saving work of Jesus Christ on the cross for his sins. We're confident in Dad's resurrection because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We will miss him from a human perspective. He was taken prematurely. Our hearts, they ache in pain. But we rejoice in his life, trusting that God's plans are not man's plans. We rejoice that he is home now with his Creator and Savior. We rejoice that he finally was able to shed that sinful, broken-down shell, and he's now clothed in righteousness, sinless before the throne of God above. I wanted to add a few comments from Cheryl, Rick's beloved daughter. These are specifically from her. There were so many reasons why I love my dad. He made loving and serving his family and others his top priority. We always knew that if we needed something, he would go to great lengths to find it for us. We always knew that, but the three things that stand out to me as to why I miss him so much are family vacations, his service to the Lord and the church, and his daily service to his family. As you've already heard, he was the ultimate vacation planner. We always knew that vacation weeks would be packed full of fun, activities, food, lots of special family time. But I always look forward to the summers when Dad would be driving the boat on the lake. He loved to build pyramids of people on the tubes and whip us around as fast as he could. He and I loved to lay up on the roof of the houseboat and look at the stars. In the winter, we enjoyed many trips to the cabin under the snow. Dad could always find the fastest sledding hills. Then in the last 10 years, when he and Mom got heavily into cross-country skiing. They would take Macy and Tobin and pull them on the poke sleds so that Andy and I could go snowboarding. Dad loved serving us any way he could. But by far my favorite family vacation was when Mom and Dad invited us to Kauai on a trip to celebrate the 35th wedding anniversary. We hadn't even made it to the hotel when Dad pulled over onto his first of many scheduled outings, hiking to a huge waterfall. Mom and I were still in our flip-flops, and he and Andy were already hiking down the hill before I could find my shoes to put on. Most couples probably wouldn't want to take their kids on the 35th anniversary, but Dad just loved being around his family. He loved sharing fun memories with us. The trip was filled with tons of exciting activities. Dad, he worked hard, but he played hard. The second thing that stands out for me is how Dad served the Lord and the church with everything he had. Growing up seemed like we were at church most nights of the week, between him leading the choir, being a WANA commander, doing special music with Mom, fulfilling deacon responsibilities, and being at every Sunday morning and evening service. There was no question he loved serving God's people. He loved everyone he served with and really loved all the kids and youth he ministered to. By far, he was the most gifted event planner and delegator that I know, and he used it to serve the Lord faithfully. But it wasn't just the vacations and the ministry involvement that stuck out to me. I loved being with my dad because he always made everyone feel welcome and special. The door was always open to our friends to hang out, stay for dinner, stay the night if they wanted to. He loved entertaining groups, very generous with what the Lord gave him. He used what the Lord gave him to serve others, and I know that I'll miss my dad because he made me feel so special. But I'm confident that he is in a much better place alongside our Lord Jesus Christ. There's a quote that from Charles Spurgeon that fits the situation as he comments on a verse in John 17 where Jesus is praying for his followers. John 17, 24 reads, "Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am." Spurgeon states the following, which sums up our feelings about losing Dad. "Oh, death, where dost touch that? Why dost thou touch the tree beneath whose spreading branches weariness hath rest? Why dost thou snatch away the excellent of the earth, in whom is all our delight? If thou must use thine axe, use it upon the trees which yield no fruit, that the mightiest might be thanked. But why wilt thou fell the goodly cedars of Lebanon? Oh, stay thine axe and spare the righteous. But no, it must not be. Death smites the goodliest of our friends, the most generous, the most powerful, the most holy, the most devoted must die. And why? It is through Jesus' prevailing prayer, 'Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am.' It is that which bears them on eagle's wings to heaven. Every time a believer mounts from this earth to paradise, it is an answer to Christ's prayer, 'Lord, that thou have them, by faith we let them go.' It is to that end that we grant our dad to your care, O Lord, and say in our hearts, as Dad said in his last days, 'Not what I will, but what you will.'"
With your
who spoke on behalf of Rick. Really, just an absolutely rich, rich experience for all of us you have provided. Even for me, as his pastor, you have filled in so many gaps and with such delight and such honesty and such joy. You have given me a picture and a knowledge of him that I didn't have, and I think we all feel that way. So thank you so very much. I think this helps us understand the loss in a way that we would not otherwise be able to understand it. you obviously were specially chosen by God to be handed a treasure, a human treasure, full of grace and truth. And that's what marked out Christ. He was full of grace and truth. And if I was picking up anything, I was picking up the Christ-likeness that you all saw in your husband and your dad and your grandpa and your brother. And Christ was real in him. And you've conveyed that to us, and you've enriched us all. Sometimes I just wish we didn't have to wait until we have a funeral to get all that information filled in so we could rush up to Rick and throw our arms around him and say, I just found out what you're really like. How wonderful. Thank you for the gift that you've given us, all of us, tonight. I certainly don't need to say much. That would be to gild the lily. Plenty has been said. Ample has been said in testimony to the work of Christ in his life. The best that a man can do is to become a good man. But the testimony regarding this man transcends what any man is capable of. The man that Rick was, only God can produce. This is a man who experienced the supernatural power of God in his life. And it shows up, not only in his life, but it shows up in all of you. So thrilling. But I am here to say something, and that is that I didn't really know the human biography, but I do know his divine biography. I can tell you the real story of Rick Wells from the heavenly perspective, from the divine side. And I would like to do that from a portion of Scripture written by the Apostle Paul. And it is such a moving thing to understand someone's life from God's viewpoint rather than from our own viewpoint. It's a remarkable thing to understand what God has purposed to do and planned to do in a life from the heavenly side. Let me read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13 and following. You have some amazing statements made there about a believer. The first one is that God has chosen you from the beginning. That's where Rick's biography began. It began in God's beginning. It began in eternity past when God predetermined to set his love on this man in time when there was no time, in a creation when there was no creation. And it was so specific that God actually wrote his name down in a book. This is the great truth of sovereign election. We give thanks to God because he chose Rick from the beginning. The second great epic in his biography is also identified here when it says he called you through our gospel. He called you through our gospel. Chosen in eternity past and called in time. This is a divine call. This is a regenerating call. This is a justifying call. This is a saving call. There was a moment in time when the Spirit of God, based upon the plan of God, called Rick to himself through the gospel. Third step in his biography took more than a moment. He was chosen before there were any moments. He was called in a moment of time. But the third step, the third phase in his life, Paul says, was through sanctification by the Spirit and faith in the truth. From what you all have said, if there's one thing true about Rick, it is that he believed in the truth. He believed in the Word of God. And through his confident, growing, enduring faith in the Word of God, the Holy Spirit sanctified him. And you all gave testimony to that. Justification and regeneration, we could say, is invisible. Election is invisible. Sanctification is visible. And you were a part of the process of God conforming him to the very truth in which he trusted by the work of the Holy Spirit. And all of this for a final and eternal aspect of his biography, that he might gain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. From election to regeneration, through sanctification to final glory. And the end was purposed in the beginning. He was chosen for eternal glory. And the plan at this moment is complete. Complete. God in his grace deposited this chosen man in your family for all of his holy purposes. I believe the greatest of which was to use him to repeat this biography in his children and in other people's children and in many other lives. So it multiplies and multiplies. He has entered into the presence of the Lord, and in the presence of the Lord he has been given his inheritance. When Peter thought about this, he wrote this doxology: Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now, for a little time, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. The distress of the trials is past. The inheritance is realized, imperishable, undefiled, unfading, having been protected by the power of God to be received in due time. It is our confidence in the great truth of election and regeneration and sanctification and glorification that causes us to be able to say with the Apostle Paul back in 2 Thessalonians 2, Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and given us eternal comfort and good hope by grace, comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. That's our prayer for you. Join me in prayer. Father, together, collectively, we lift up our praise and thanks to you. For Rick Wells, we thank you for the grace gift that he was to his family, to all who knew him. We thank you for depositing him in our lives to enrich us. Thank you for using him outside of his family to influence so many in his efforts in ministry. And we don't need to rehearse all these things because they are part of the very warp and woof of all our lives. To whatever degree we knew him, we have been enriched. And we can all say that. And we're grateful for the gift that he was. The memory will not fade. The joys will abide and endure. And even more wonderfully, the reunion is very near. For our lives, at best, are like a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. And we are soon in your presence. We look forward to that day even more now. Heaven always had its attraction, but that attraction has been significantly escalated because of Rick's homegoing. At the same time, Lord, we understand that there are some gathered with us tonight who will never see Rick again if they do not put their trust in Jesus Christ, the only Savior, the only way to heaven. And not just for the sake of a reunion, but for the sake of escaping hell and entering the glory and the joy of heaven. May we all face the reality of our mortality, the inevitability of death, the fact that we will all die and we're not normally in charge of when and how that happens. And we must be ready before it happens. May all our hearts open to the only hope, the only one who can save us from judgment, the Lord Jesus Christ, who died to bear our sins and rose again to provide eternal life. May every heart be turned to him. We know that if Rick were here, he would say, "It's far more than I ever imagined. And don't miss it. Don't miss it." We thank you, Lord, that we don't need to if we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless the family, give them comfort, encouragement, even a measure of joy. Lift them up, protect them. May the testimony of Rick to this family extend through to the little ones. And may they grow to love the Christ their Poppy loved as well. And we commit them all to you with thankful hearts in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. We want to sing a hymn, two verses, the first and third of hymn number 43. Hymn number 43. Great is thy faith. from stumbling, and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. As you know, once the family leaves, there will be an opportunity for you to greet them across campus in the family center. I know that would be a real joy to have you do that.